And that's partly because I thought it would be really useful to take stock of where we are and to do more of a position paper. And for that reason, I'm going to read, which is very unusual for me. But I guess it's because I think we're now at a stage of maturity in research on LGBTQI parenthood and queer kinship more generally, where we can reflect and start to maybe think differently. So whilst we must be careful not to advance a globalising or westernised orthodoxy, it is true to say, it would be hard to contest, that for many parts of the world there have been great advances in socio-legal queer rights, and most of these have clustered around partnership and parenthood. And they have broken down the homo and hetero binaries, and it's hard to argue that's negative in many ways. But however seemingly progressive and welcome, there is still a cost. So whilst cultural studies and queer theorising has sought to critically engage with and critique socio-legal advances, in many ways empirical research on same-sex parenthood has largely glossed over the problematic of contemporary equality rights and focused instead on opportunities and the things that are presented there. So queer parenthood research all too often instantiates heteronormative gender and sexuality through insufficient attention to everyday experience and the ways in which this queers kinship, geopolitical and socio-cultural context, are used as scene setting rather than being operationalised to prise apart the intersections of the public and the private and the public-private intimacies. Genealogy is once again defining families, albeit queer practice of conception now fix the boundaries rather than thinking something like Talpa Parsons and family function. So I contend that we need to refocus attention onto the everyday and emotionality to contextualise experience and shed light on how we relate to and engage with others and the social world around us. So my provocation is, I've animated these slides, it's a big move forward for me, and I know you've all been doing this for a very long time. In these Janus-faced, permissive and precarious times, whose lives matter in research on LGBTQ parenthood? How is queer parenthood materialised? And how can our research better reflect contemporary matter-of-fact queer experience? So I want to lay out and unpick some of the characteristic factors that are, as I see it anyway, defining contemporary queer parenthood research. Gender and sexuality being the obvious ones. Research on queer parent families often reinforces sexual gender categories through the investigative focus on one unit of analysis. Whilst this makes good empirical research sense, it also works against the fluidity of gender that characterises queer research more generally and the ways in which people inhabit, experience and strategically occupy multiple genders in everyday parenting. Subsequent analysis does try to mess it up a bit, and we have people talking about lesbian dads or two mothers, but the resilience of primary embodied gender typically remains the starting point of analysis and thus serves as the analytical capstone. And I'm mindful here that I'm involved in another project around young people and gender. And in workshops, this group of young people are just saying, they were listing all of the different genders, and they come up with a list of 24 genders. Well, if we think of the papers at this conference, how many people are talking about 24 genders? About that level of multiplicity. So we are shutting things down rather than opening them up. I find that interesting. And if we look at the activities that we do during the day and the interactions that we have with others, as we go about being parents, then gender arguably loses its a priori status. And this isn't to suggest that the materiality of experience should be erased, and it really should not, but gendered inequalities persist in every sphere of public and private life. So we have to think about how we embody gender, how we do gender, and it seems really basic, but when we're doing empirical studies of parenthood, suddenly it becomes something quite visceral. So in same-sex parent families, I suggest that if we shift the lens from differentiated genders in our descriptions of everyday life, and then deploy it strategically when impacts on experience, then we can advance a more nuanced understanding of when and how gender matters. Similarly so, sexualities. Sexual identities are typically fixed in research, in the research moment, rather than situated in life pools. Sexual biographies and the fluidity of sexuality more generally. So I think in some ways research is advancing what you could actually see as a sexuality snapshot that fleetingly immortalises the sexual subject in time. Biographical narratives can help to situate the participant in life pools, but the speaking subject bears the weight of sexual identity. And it is this sexual subject that has been recruited to research, and their account will be analysed through this point, this temporal moment of subjectivity. But more than this, as with gender, I want to also suggest that for same-sex parents, for most of the time, sexuality is probably insignificant. Parenthood ordinarily overrides other points of identification, and everyday parenting leaves little time for anything which signifies, let alone materialises, sexuality. And I was interested when Christian was talking about when you were talking about polyparenting, and actually are we talking polyparenting or parents who are polyamorous? It is not linguistics, it is not semantics, it is actually important, I think, to think about what we're saying when we describe our research subjects. So, for example, the routines of parenthood take precedence. Children's emotional and practical needs overshadow those of parents and the parental couple. And places of intimacy, such as parents' bedrooms, lose their definition and become re-inscribed as family space. So in same-sex parent families, where is the sexuality? Where is the sexual orientation? And so parenthood in many ways erases the materiality of sexuality. And if time permitted, I really could show you a 20-year catalogue of data that I have, where we can see how sexuality loses its importance. And we can think about the children's adverse impact on parents' sex lives, from co-sleeping to tiredness to dungeons being turned into children's playrooms. It really does matter when children enter into a family household. And then there's the geopolitical and social cultural context, and the particularity of experience and how this is rendered meaningful through understandings of the temporal, political, socio-cultural situation of others is often sidelined. So research location is typically used to foreground a study and to situate the sample and analysis in context. But once this contextual scene setting is done, analysis progresses unencumbered by factors outside the analytical focus. So I contend that rather than use context to situate our research, it should be instead operationalised in research. It should be ever-present and inform the framing of research questions and of analysis of findings. This means, for example, that we acknowledge that equality rights are measured and come to be known and experienced through inequality, prejudice, homophobia and stigma, so on and so forth. I.e., we know about equal rights through what is unequal, what is unfair, what is stigmatising. It also draws attention to the significance of other factors above and beyond parenthood and or same-sex parent family life, for example. And these contextual factors, such as in the Enduring Love Study, I will mention it because you said it wasn't. So the other contextual factors, So, for example, when we were researching long-term couple relationships, couples diversely constituted in multiple different ways, what we didn't think we were going to find, and we did, and we can say this across all research in terms of LGBTQI research, is that we have a high incidence of mental health amongst our sample, amongst our participants, even if we don't go looking for it. And yet how many people, when they're doing their papers, mention this? We just gloss over. We don't mention some of that stuff. Or we may sideline it and mention it in a separate paper. Power, mentioned this morning, power and inequalities between parents, experience and circumstances that differentiate LGBTQ parent families from each other are often more telling in shaping LGBTQ parenthood. So in the UK, for example, lesbian and gay people of all ages may now share equal socio-legal rights, but these do not have straightforward equivalence of impact. Younger queers have grown up knowing they can form civil partnerships, can get married, have children, even share pensions. Not that they'll be worth anything, but you can still share them. And their embrace or repudiation of these equalities of opportunity are thus very, very different from older generations whose lives were shaped through the experience of stigma and lack of opportunity. Indeed, reading through some data recently, I was struck by marked generational differences in how people express themselves and their affections. And that seems really obvious, but we may forget that civil partnership rights, for example, same-sex marriage rights, are experienced very much through a generational axis. But cutting across this, it's location, where and when, which confined expressions, so PDAs, public displays of affection, on the street, down the pub, and at home. So over and over again, I heard phrases like, not on this estate, never. Where you live determines how you can be, how you can experience yourselves. And in contemporary studies of LGBTQ parenthood, the decontextualisation of research has resulted in a plethora of writing which presents an able, neoliberal citizen picking from a smorgasbord of choices that have been afforded through advances in seemingly progressive equal rights. But choices are not free-floating signifiers of opportunity and agency. They are political and they are defined by context. Demographic factors are not simply variables. They may define the research sample, but the elitism of queer conception, both in terms of financial outlay and also the capacity to imagine planned parenthood, remains insufficiently analysed. Social, economic and educational disadvantage, in UK terms what we would call class, remains fundamental in the experience of queer kinship and LGBTQ parenthood. Queer parenthood is situated. And then conception and reproductive narratives. The research focus on how babies and how families are made, donor conception, IVF, surrogacy, obscures the multiplicity of kinship narratives that characterise past and present experiences of parenthood, adult-child relationships. This focus serves to reinforce heteronormative ideas of coupledom through privileging dyadic parenthood, and conversely, in so doing, obscures queer kinship and the wider networks of intimacy that may actually be present. Boundaries of types of relating are set up, separating the sexual, non-sexual, the parent, the partner, friends, and family. Whilst this is certainly not ordinarily the intention of researchers, it nevertheless analytically reinforces heteronormative and actually specious relationship categories. In the Enduring Coupledom project, I'm struck by the presence of pets. Where are the pets today? Okay. I don't mean physically in the room, I've heard you can't bring dogs. But where are the other species? Where are the other things that make our kin networks emotionally important? So the early vestiges of radical potentiality that were present in families of choice have now in many ways been overwhelmed by biogenetic imperatives. The academic fascination with means of conception as the defining criteria for unit of analysis both buys into and reincarnates the pronatalist agenda. Starting a family, scare quotes, is now part of the queer life trajectory, materialised in the permanence of bricks and mortar, which embed futurity into the very construct of the household. Irrespective of sexuality, the adult couple is crafted through parental responsibilities, which include combining work and child rearing, economic self-sufficiency, educational aspiration, and conformity of behaviour. The child and the neoliberal citizen are simultaneously born. So the intensification of parenthood, which Carl's already mentioned, now drives the queer intimate agenda. And notwithstanding the rich insights that were afforded through small-scale studies on one or other routes into family making, it's also timely to remind ourselves of the plethora of ways that LGBTQ parent families come into being. So, I've checked this does translate. Parading some elephants in the room. Research modalities. Most sexualities research is completed by junior scholars, and LGBTQ parenthood is no exception. In fact, to the contrary, it resides on the margins of the margins, and it's an invidious consequence of queer studies being shut down through privileging normative research in appointment and promotion processes. Sexualities research is therefore predominantly small scale and typically qualitative. And if anyone wants to talk about how much glass you have to crawl over to get promotion when you do sexuality studies, I am happy to talk about how painful it can be. You can do it, but it's really hard because you're always having small citations, you're always having small research. Research training reinforces the need for tightly defined topics with clearly identified research questions which must drive the research sample. And the PhD process is a prescribed journey, now more so than ever before, with methods training, literature review, upgrade, fieldwork, writing up, in 3 years, and if you're really lucky, 4 years, but mostly 3 years. Research grants are now few and far between, with a success rate of between 5 and 10% on average. And the edict of value for money leads to quick and dirty research, which delivers robust evidence, public engagement, and impact. These at best aim to refine services and inform policy rather than challenge the status quo. The era of spending time in the field to observe, engage with, and explore feels far removed from the frenetic, outcomes-driven research agenda of today. And this, I can hear laughs of, oh God, I know. This contemporary knowledge-producing context is significant. By looking ever inwards, we externalise the factors that shape both the lives of our participants and the field of study. The need for research questions and analytic focus are crucial to empirical investigation of LGBTQ parent families, and I would certainly advocate guarding these with jealousy and conviction. However, we also need to be mindful and attentive to the other factors which shape our research and the lives of others who fall outside of our analytical frame of reference. Sampling perils. I am a sampling queen. I live by sampling grids. But race, socioeconomic, and educational disadvantage, for example, inflect our data, even when they are declared absent from the predominantly white, semi-professional, higher than average sample. I'm not going to say how many people here have already said that, yes, my sample were higher than average earners, they were middle class, da-di-da-di-da. We have to try harder to reach the hard to reach, because they're out there, we are out there. It is important that we think about who we are researching, because people who do not have higher levels of education are still queer parents, for example. And the focus on one point of family formation is rendered meaningful through its relation to other reproductive modalities. Surrogacy, for example, seldom falls within the imagination of a working class man. Likewise, IVF and even donor insemination, which covered a financial cost. So when we're studying certain subjects, who are we actually saying we're not going to look at? And why are we doing that? Is there a different way of doing something? And yet it's these foci which characterise work in the field and the papers at this conference. Research beyond the heteronorm, queer wills being a good example here, all too often sit at the periphery of queer parenting. There is a marked decline, often an absence, of queer families conceived through former heterosexual partnerships. Yet, let's just think statistics, heterosexual partnerships remain the largest statistical means through which families come into formation. They're part of the material diversity of LGBTQ parent families, for men, for women, for trans, for all groups. Previous heterosexual relationships are important. Thank you. Geotemporal research context. So a further and perhaps more prescient point is that irrespective of the initial unit of analysis, political contexts need to be incorporated into all of our studies. So in the UK, every study on LGBTQ parenthood should at the moment, I honestly believe, include the impact of Brexit, with all its sickening ramifications and generative acts of resistance, because these will surely impact in some shape or form. LGBT families do not exist in a queer bubble. So if we think of who is our research sample, multinational UK and EU queer families now face some of the most serious challenges that may literally rip them apart. Conversely, the devastating contemporary political arena means that strategic political alliances such as Lesbians and Gay Support the Migrants and the global anti-Trump movements are part of the queer family landscape, whether implicitly or explicitly. So I'm not trying to suggest that all research must now include a question on X or Y, to the contrary. Micro and macro networks of relations intersect and overlap in everyday emotional scenarios. People feel the immediacy of their intimate connection in ordinary daily encounters. Materiality and emotionality are important, and we need to hone the analytical lens onto the momentary and the emotional. The macro focus requires intensive, in-depth analytical work, but drilling down into our data requires that we move beyond description and the personal to examine the ways that public-private lives intersect. They're not separate. The wide-ranging networks of intimacy that constitute LGBTQ parent families are political. So rather than closing the door of the family home and looking inwards, it's important to account for the ways in which outside the political is manifest within everyday lives and love. So in summary,
10 seconds.
I can do that. I want to reiterate that what others on this platform and other papers here have already said, and to be mindful of context and keep reminding ourselves that the personal is political and our research is political. And this doesn't mean that we must overclaim the import of our research or craft political meanings when there's scant evidence in our data or seek out the activist subject to make a political point or even start making banners and join protest movements. We probably should do that latter, all of us. But it does mean that we need to use our power and our academic voices to evidence the material impact of the pervasive precarities and the ways they're shaping lived lives and contemporary intimacies.